Welcome, folks, to Citizens for the Accountability of Government Incorporated. With me today, I have a good friend of mine, Dave Frank, is going to be here with me for the full hour, and we're going to be talking about things that affect each and every one of us. And Dave is a board member of the Citizens United for Better Government, and also Stand Up America. So he's You've been around quite a way, Dave.
Been around a long time, George.
Well, you and I both have been around a long time. Dave, I know we got a lot to talk about in this hour. I don't know whether you can handle it or not. I'm pretty sure you can.
I think we can, George.
And we're going to talk about things that affect each and every one of us in this community and outside of this community. And so I'm going to let Dave take off on some of the things. We'll be talking back and forth. And so, Dave, I'm happy to have you with me on it. You and I have been together for a long time.
Yes, we have. Yeah, we met when you were fighting the wheel tax.
Yeah.
Isn't it the wheel tax?
That's right. Yeah.
And that's when I met you, and I said, this guy is tough, and he's right. And we've been friends ever since, and we both care so much about this community, and we both care about the people in this community, and we need to change this community, George. I mean, we can't just keep sitting here and letting them, you know, impose taxes on everybody. These taxes have wrecked our community. You know, I'm from here. I know you're from Southern Indiana, and you were a councilman in Southern Indiana for 18 years,
yeah.
And you were also at the Nuremberg trials, right?
Right.
And you started National Flag Celebration.
That's correct.
That's quite a legacy, my friend.
Among other things.
Yeah, but we both care about our country, and we care about our community. And when I heard what you were doing years ago when it came to the wheel tax, you know, that made all the sense in the world to me, and I think a lot of other people. And I think, you know, when I became an activist, it was about 22 years ago when I first heard about NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, when I heard they were going to take the good jobs in America and give them to slaves in other countries. I thought, you know, the people that are promoting this is really treasonous. I mean, the decisions that they were making at that time were they were intentionally trying to destroy the most productive country on the planet. I mean, look how productive we were during World War II.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have such talent here, but when they started giving tax advantages to these corporations to do away with the workers in America and give those jobs to slaves in other countries. And that was after we had a civil war in America to hopefully do away with slavery. And then when these people in Washington, D.C. started giving tax advantages to these corporations so that they could promote using workers in other countries, which increased the bottom line for these corporations because they really didn't have to pay for labor. The next thing you know, they have these huge bottom lines, and the CEOs and the CFOs of these companies start giving themselves these obscene incomes. I mean, I couldn't believe that every American didn't stand up and go absolutely crazy.
Well, they were like little puppets.
I guess they were.
Yeah.
And then the next thing for me, I was doing a radio program back then called Stand Up America. But the next thing for me was when the situation in Waco, Texas with the Branch Davidians, when we watched United States military equipment that we the taxpayers, paid for, where they used that against American citizens.
Yeah.
And they burned almost 100 men, women, and children alive. And the American people didn't go absolutely crazy during that issue. I just couldn't believe it. But I've been an activist ever since. And I've been watching the decisions that have been made in Washington, D.C. and how it trickles down and it affects our community, and the decisions that have been made in state capitals, how those decisions affect our community. And then watching the decisions that the politicians make in our community with our tax money. It just seems to me as though every American should be upset and appalled at what's going on in this country. But like you said, I mean, when are they going to stand up?
Well, we've tried to get them to stand up.
We do.
Time and time again, we've tried to get them to stand up, and all they think about was, well, maybe, I don't want to get involved.
Right, right. You know, it's, I don't want to get involved.
Oh, no,
I don't. Isn't now, George, you were at the Nuremberg trials.
Yes.
And in Germany, before it came became Nazi Germany, what happened was the economy fell apart, which opened the door for Hitler and Nazi Germany to flourish. But what they didn't do in Nazi Germany, or in Germany before it became Nazi Germany, is the people didn't stand up, right?
Well, they didn't stand up because for the fear of the brown shirts and all that organization, because they were a bunch of mean people.
Yeah.
And they'd knock your head off just because you coughed.
Well, you know, our government's getting to be pretty mean, too. We've got, we have over 2.5 million people in jails and prisons in this country. And when you think about the fact that the laws that have been passed are really coming from lobbyists representing special interests, which are corporations, we're now waking up to the fact that corporations are really running America. And what's sort of interesting is if you look at the word corporations, and the abbreviation of corporations is C-O-R-P-S, corpse. That
dead?
That equates to death. And basically corpse. What we have now is death leading America. And but what we've got to do is we've got to take our country back, and we've got to do it in a peaceful way, and we have to do it the right way. But we're fortunate, George. We live in a world that's full of communication technology now. And what we have to do is we have to stop believing that Washington, D.C. is going to fix our country. They can't fix our country. It's part of a multi-level marketing pyramid scam where we're sending 535 lawyers $3 trillion a year. And for people that don't know what $3 trillion is, it's 3 million. It's the greatest prize ever known to mankind.
I never stopped to figure that out, David.
It's huge. It's huge. It makes the Roman Empire look weak. And so we've got that, and then we've got in state capitals, we're sending all this money to 150 people in state capitals that make decisions for us. We send that money to them, and we wait for them to send it back to us, and it never comes back.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, look at state capitals. Look at Indianapolis today. It looks like the Emerald City. And so that's a scam, too. And then you have what's going on downtown, which is, you know, when they take $10 million of our tax monies that we paid to benefit the children in their education system, and they use that, and they give it to the former mayor for his ball team. You know, we gave it to Kovaleski so that they could redo Kovaleski so that the former mayor who owned the ball team could sell the ball team and put money in his pocket. And that same $10 million, now the kids, the education system is shy $10 million, and now they're firing teachers, they're firing aides. Some schools don't have nurses. The healthcare system for the nurses and the aides and the people that work for the school corporation, it's falling apart. The teachers are quitting because they can't afford the healthcare. But instead of that $10 million going to where we wanted it to go, it went to Kovaleski, and our education system is falling apart. The question is why do we want to keep doing this, George?
No, we don't want to keep doing it. Somebody else wants to keep doing
it. That's right. They don't want anything
to
change.
The people in power wants to keep doing that.
Well, isn't that the definition of insanity? Doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results.
What was that thing you told me one time? I'm trying to think what you called...
Politics?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, God's trying to tell us something. The word politics, if you dissect it, a tick is a bloodsucker, and politics means many bloodsuckers.
Yeah.
Right?
That's what you told me.
There you go.
A year or two ago.
And here's another one. How about the opposite of progress, which progress or progress means to move forward, the opposite of that is Congress. move backwards.
Move backwards.
And that's when we give our money to these 535 people. They misappropriate it. They feed themselves. They feed their cronies. And our country's falling apart. But the good news is this can all be fixed.
Yeah, but you know, you're speaking out about this, but how many other people are doing this?
Well, not enough.
Not enough.
But George, because of the fact that you were so diligent in bringing our community public access, and you did a great job. I mean, this thing, public access was shut down for what, 6-7 years?
Yes.
And you said, that's wrong. The community is receiving money from Cablevision, Comcast, to provide public access, but the people downtown, instead of appropriating that money to...
spend it for something else.
They spent it on something else.
Yes.
But you kept pushing them, George.
I kept pushing.
You kept pushing them, and finally we have public access. Now we have a platform where people like George Lane or Dave Frank or Mario Sims, Sam Brown, Jasmine Brown, people like that, they can use this technology now to get ideas out and hopefully wake the people in our community up.
Well, we knew that, Dave.
That's right.
We knew we had to have this.
Is that why the politicians did not want to appropriate this money?
Yes, the former mayor. Now, this mayor is altogether different. This mayor he got on board real quick. And the former mayor, he didn't want nothing to do it because he don't let somebody make a Mickey Mouse sign and hold it up. But anyway, that's when it stopped, you know.
But we have public access now.
Finally.
And I do a program. It's called Stand Up America. And what I do is I use my program to get a message out to the people that we really don't have to do this anymore. We have to make some drastic changes in our community. I mean, when you turn on national news, you hear about this fiscal cliff.
Oh, yeah.
How America's running out of money. And that's a very scary thing, because when we run out of money, that means the banks go broke. That means that when you go to use your debit and credit or credit card,
you don't have any money.
You don't have any money.
Right.
You want to go buy groceries, and other people are thinking the same things, and all of a sudden, you go to the store and people start fighting over groceries and things get very scary. That's what's going on in other countries.
Oh, my land, what's happening in our country here? You say, you know, I'll tell you what, how many people in Congress up there?
Well, there are 535.
Yeah, I'd say about 400 of them, nothing but people scalping you.
Well, look, there's 300 million people in America, and when you ask 535 for their opinion, that's not a very good litmus test as to what we the people want. And I don't think that when our founding fathers said we the people, they meant just 535. I think they meant everybody.
Yeah, we the people.
Right. And we have the technology today, George, where we can all have a voice. We don't have to rely on some politician to do our thinking for us. We can start thinking for ourselves.
Well, that's what you do, Dave. You speak out about these things. And you speaking out against these things, you know, we all believe in this. We think that the politicians is just scalping us, take it for a ride. Just like you mentioned about, what about the... was it a thing that...
Kobolewski or what? Give me a hint.
What is it? The Hall of Shame.
Oh, the Football Hall of Fame. we were there. We were at that meeting. This was like 20 years ago, begging the city council not to waste $14 million of our money. It was going to be a failure. Everybody knew it was. It was a failure in Ohio, and the former mayor Kernan promised us it was not going to cost the citizens a dime.
Oh, he just made a mistake, didn't he?
Oh, he made a mistake, all right.
He just made a mistake.
And we begged him not to use that money because we had big problems in our community. We needed that money for education. We needed it for infrastructure. We needed it for the police. We needed it for the things that we, the people, pay taxes for, that we believe in. But he went ahead and the city council appropriated that money for the Football Hall of Fame. And it's been a drag on our community ever since. And from what I understand, I think it's so far it's ended up costing us about $35 million out of our pocket. And it's been a failure. But that's another example as to what happens when politicians don't listen to we the people. It's our money. It's our community. This community doesn't belong to nine people on the city council. It doesn't belong to a mayor. It belongs to everybody. And that's why I push a plan to give everyone in our community a voice. You know, George, we have all these different television channels now. We have the travel channel, we have the food channel, we have the sports channel. We have all these different channels, but we don't have the most important channel. And the most important channel is the local issues channel.
Right.
And the
right.
local issues channel will be our channel that will allow we the people to start coming up with ideas to make our education system better, ideas to make our environment better, ideas for a better tax system, all kinds of ideas out there that we the people can now start presenting, not to the politicians, because, you know, government is where great ideas go to die. We can now present our ideas directly to the people in our community. They can hear these ideas over our local issues television and radio channel. We can debate these ideas because we want the people in our community to be educated before they vote, right, on an
right.
issue. And
some people do.
That's right. That's right.
Not all of them.
Yeah, well, up until now, the people in our community have been left in the dark on the issues. I mean, if you went up to anybody out on the street right now and said to them, hey, do you know what issue the city council or the county council is voting on this week?
No.
They wouldn't have any idea. You know why? Because the city and the county council really doesn't want you to know what they're voting on. There's 267,000 people in St. Joe County. There are probably enough seats up there to hold 100, maybe.
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 So they put them in there like sardines.
There you go. So yeah. The plan is let's use the technology that we have today to fire up a local issues television and radio channel. In fact, I think public broadcasting would be an excellent channel to use to broadcast the public. That's my goal, to use public broadcasting to actually broadcast the public to start tapping into these ideas. It's a channel that everyone in our community has access to. If you have cable, you can get public broadcasting. If you have Dish, you can. If you have none of it, you can still get public broadcasting. So we'll use that to broadcast the public, get these ideas out there. And then, you know, keep in mind, we're voting on American Idol, we vote on Dancing with the Stars, we vote on CNN, we vote on Fox, we vote on all these different venues, but we aren't voting on important issues in our lives.
Giving people an opportunity to say how they think.
That's right. That's right. And so when somebody sees an issue on television, for example, that let's use that $10 million that they just appropriated to go to Kovaleski as opposed to our kids, that issue should have been given right to the public. We could have debated it, voted on it with any touch-tone phone. You can vote with any touch-tone phone. Your call will go into a community computer that will have your citizen participation identification number. The computer will verify you as a voter, ask what issue number you want to vote on, press 1 for yes, 2 for no, count your vote, block you out from voting more than once. We can now have decisions made of the people, by the people, and for the people, just like the Constitution tried to do 235 years ago. The problem is, George, is 235 years ago, they didn't know what a paperclip was.
No.
They didn't know what a rubber band was.
No, they sure
they
didn't.
Definitely didn't know what a touch-tone phone, a computer, and a television is. But today we have these things. And remember, our founding fathers were inventors. And if they were inventing a new system for America today, I guarantee they'd be liking this system, because it is truly of the people, by the people, and for the people.
That's one of the finest things that I ever think have been invented.
I do too.
Gives the people access.
Absolutely. And think of all the lives that this thing has saved.
Oh, my.
You know, years ago, if you were traveling out in the country, yeah, and God forbid you had a car accident,
that's right,
you'd just lay there and die.
Where are you going to go?
nobody knew about you.
No.
But now if you have a problem, you can call 911.
This is technology.
It's technology.
That's right.
And it's exciting. And it's exciting, and it gives everyone a voice, because think about it. We go through our lives collecting all this information, but what good is this information if we can't use it? And by hooking up this system locally, all of a sudden we can start tapping into, hey, you're over, what are you, over 50 years old now,
right,
George?
Oh, yeah, I'm over 50, yeah.
And you've been collecting a lot of information.
Lots of information.
Lots of information.
Yeah.
And if we don't hook something like this up, there are people like you and myself, elderly people, around the country, around the community, that have, they're just chock full of all this information.
Oh, yeah.
It's our greatest natural resource, and we aren't tapping into it. We have these people sitting in nursing homes. Nobody's talking to them.
Nobody talking to them.
And now all of a sudden, those people, we can start tapping into what they know, what they think, what they believe, and we can get them to start using this thing.
Well, we have these universities around here, Dave. Notre Dame. Very prominent university, Indiana, South Bend, Bethel out there. We've got some brains in this
brilliant
community.
Brilliant people in this community.
But we don't have an opportunity to tap onto that for the outside people.
That's right.
And what it is, it's right there in that little vicinity right there. That's where the education thing's going. We need to educate the people out here.
That's right.
And just exactly what we're doing here today is we're trying to educate the people on what's happening in this country. Around the world, as a matter of fact, and we're doing it here with this program, but I want to thank Angel for helping us out and get this. Angel's a dandy, isn't
he? He is wonderful, and we're really fortunate to have the crew here at Public Access. And I think they really believe in what we're doing.
I think they do too.
And but we've got to draw a line in the sand, and we just can't not continue to do this any longer.
We have to grow.
We have to grow. And George, yeah. I'm going to steal a term that you gave me years ago. You know, when out of 267,000 brain cells or people in St. Joe County, when you only use 9, like people on the city council or one mayor, yeah, or 9 on the county council, you know what that's called?
What is it?
Brain dead.
Brain dead. I gave you that phrase
you
a long
did.
Time ago.
You didn't. I've been using it ever since.
Brain
but,
dead.
But that's why our education system doesn't work. That's why our environment's in trouble. That's why our tax system makes absolutely no sense. Think about the property tax system. We have people in our community that are losing their homes because they can't afford to pay this dysfunctional property tax. It's totally unconstitutional, because the only people that were supposed to have voices according to the Constitution were property owners. When they imposed property taxes on the business owners and the residents in our communities, not only in our community, but communities around the country, all of a sudden we don't own property any longer. We lease our property from the state.
Yeah, that's right.
And we've had so many businesses fold because they can't afford their property taxes. And you know, South Bend, St. Joe County, now that I'm older, I can reflect back on this. It wasn't built by big business. It was built by small business. And if these
like your dad's store,
that my grandfather's store, he had a place called Max Adler's here in town, and I had Frank's Red Hots in mm-hmm. South Bend for 15 years. But property taxes were always a problem, you know, when I had my place, and it's even worse today, because what happened was, when the federal government quit giving money to the state and the state quit giving money to the local government, what happened was the state and the local got together and they said, hey, wait a minute, we've got these property taxes, we can raise the property taxes. Mm-hmm. But the people in Indianapolis and downtown weren't smart enough to realize that every time you raise property taxes, it pushes the value of your property down, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
And they kept raising it, kept pushing the property down until it was like a blister and it popped.
It's just like right now, David. If you want to sell your home, I don't know, I paid close to $200,000 for my home, and if I tried to sell it, I could never get that out of it.
That's right.
and I'm paying taxes on that.
Right.
At that rate.
That's right.
And I can't get rid of it. There's no way.
Yeah.
I'm stuck.
Yeah. And a lot of people are, and that's why there's so many vacant properties here. You know, the only thing that these guys can come up with downtown is, well, let's knock them down. But they aren't smart enough to realize that if you get rid of the cancer that's attached to the property tax, then all of a sudden people that still have money, they'll go out and they'll buy these properties up to either live in or to rent them or to fix them and resell them. But what will happen is they'll hire thousands of people in our community, bricklayers, plumbers, electricians, to fix these properties up, and it'll put people to work immediately.
Oh, we don't want to do that, do we?
No, that wouldn't be good.
That wouldn't be good.
Because you know what would happen if those people start working, then they go out to lunch, and they go out to dinner, and they start paying for things in our community, and all of a sudden our community starts to work.
They could go to these stores and buy. They could buy cars. They could do this.
Absolutely.
With the money that they're making.
Absolutely.
We don't want to do that, do we?
No, but that would take the people that are representing us actually communicating with us and tapping into the ideas that we have, as opposed to us sitting around like, you know, the three monkeys. Waiting for them to hear, see, and speak no evil.
Right.
Waiting for them to come up with the solutions. I mean, I couldn't believe it. One of the solutions that they came up with downtown to utilize the St. Joe River, which happens to be one of the best fisheries in the country. Most people don't know that because they've never marketed the St. Joe River.
Well, they're getting ready to market, though.
They want to put more bars around the St. Joe River so that we have more people drinking in St. Joe County. And every day you turn on the news or you open the newspaper and you hear about people that were killed or killed somebody else because they were drinking. And the geniuses downtown, their answer to this problem is, let's let people buy a liquor license for $1,000 and they can start selling more booze in our community. You know, the only one that really wins with this alcohol issue is Indianapolis makes more money off the sale of alcohol than anyone else or state capitals. And then you got the lawyers sitting here waiting, laughing all the way to the bank because after you have an accident, they're there waiting to pick your bones, right? Because you don't want to go to prison or whatever. There are just no common sense ideas in our community any longer. That's the problem. That's why we need to set up a system where we can start finding these ideas.
When you know, David, when they set up these people, these, what do you call them? They're fundraising people. What am I trying to
mean,
say?
For campaigns or?
No, for commissions. They've set up these commissions and everything. Who are they made up? They're not made up of people like you and I.
No.
They're made up of the big guys.
Yeah.
And these big guys is the things that's causing all the problems.
Right.
And you ever see them appoint somebody like Dave Frank to one of these boards?
They wouldn't want me on there.
Well, they don't. They haven't ever asked me, do you want to be appointed to one of these boards? I think you and I'd have a lot to tell them.
Well,
but
George, I'm 64 years old now. I've never been asked my opinion. Those people on those boards have never come to me, or have they come to you and asked your opinion? They don't do that.
I haven't. None of them asked me my opinion. All they want to do is vote for me. Vote for me. Vote for
me. There you go.
Vote for me, and I want to take good care of you.
Oh, they have all the answers, don't they?
I want to take good care of you.
Yeah. Can I? While I'm on your program, can I explain how easy this can be?
Sure.
Okay. Basically, what we want to do is we want to build this local issues television and radio channel so that when you, the people, have an idea to make our community better, you can present your idea directly to the community. What we need is a filtering system. And when we hook up the broadcasting station so that they can send their ideas out, and also the computer that will contain their citizen participation identification numbers, what we want to do is have a filtering system so that we the people don't have to listen to silly issues. And what will happen is the computer every week will pick 10 people at random, and they'll be our representatives for that week. And they're only going to be there for a week, and then we'll put some new ones in the following week and the following week. And the reason that you do that is the same reason the judicial system gets